Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Last week, in the Seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we reach the hisar, the issue of hisar of Quraysh, the blockade of Quraysh against Banu Abdul Muttalib and Banu Hashim due to their support of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Muslims. And this hisar, this blockade of the Quraysh against Banu Abdul Muttalib and Banu Hashim lasted for how long? Barakallahu feek. It lasted for 3 years. And this hisar was a hisar that was a blockade or sanctioning a siege on the Muslims. And, yeah, Ibn Sulaiman, was it only on the Muslims? Barakallahu feek. Against the two tribes. The Muslims of them and the Mushrikeen from amongst them as well. And also, we looked at a year in which the ulama have named Amul Huzn, the year of sadness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A year after the Hisar, after the blockade, it was a year, 6 months after the blockade, it was a year in which two calamities befell the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And these two great calamities were the death of Abu Talib and the death of Khadija radiallahu anha. And we say calamities because death is a calamity, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَإِذَا أَصَابَتْكُمْ مُصِيبَةُ الْمَوْتِ. And when you're overtaken by the calamity of death. But death is enough of a calamity, but what is greater as a calamity upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was great upon him, was the way in which Abu Talib, he died. And that calamity is Abu Talib, he passed away as a mushrik. Despite the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was saying to him, قُلْ لَا إِلَىٰ إِلَىٰ اللَّهِ, say لَا إِلَىٰ إِلَىٰ اللَّهِ. But in his presence was who? Abu Jahl, and what else? Another mushrik, Abdullah ibn Abi Rabi'a, was saying to him, أَتَرْغَبْ عَمْ مِلَّةِ عَبْدِ الْمُطَلِبِ. Are you going to deviate from the millah Abu Muttalib, Abdul Muttalib? So he died as a mushrik. And Abbas, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam after that, saying to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, مَا أَغْنَيْتَ عَنْ عَمِّكَ. What could you do for your uncle? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, دعوة في الضحضاح من النار. That Abu Talib is in fire which is up to his ankles. And this fire is so severe in heat, it will cause his brain to boil. That's the most that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam could do for his uncle Abu Talib. So this was year was known as Amul Huzn, a year of sadness for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So as we were saying, in this year of Amul Huzn of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the calamity of the death of Abu Talib was also calamity because it was the one that defended the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He brought the two tribes, Banu Hashim and Banu Abdul Muttalib, to defend the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then after his death, the mushrikeen, they saw other ways. They saw a weakness to persecute and directly try to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even though Hamza and Umar Khattab, they were there. So in this environment of hostility, at this time of sadness, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he decided he's going to leave Mecca and go to Taif. Maybe he'll find somebody that will lend ear to his da'wah. Maybe he'll find a heart that understands his call. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Taif to seek a land which is fertile for da'wah. So he left Mecca and went to Taif. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went to Taif, he went with Zayd ibn Haritha. And who's Zayd ibn Haritha? The free slave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and also who? The adopted, when it was permissible, adopted son of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so he went to Taif. Now he went from Mecca to Taif, subhanallah. And when I used to live in Jeddah, I always wanted to go to Taif. And not for any religious or particular sunnah reason, because not sunnah or religious reason to go to Taif, just to experience it. And I said that day, me and my family are going to go to Taif, and we're going to go to Mecca afterwards. We're going to go to Haram. Taif, Mecca. Not knowing the distance between Taif and Mecca is very far, even by road, by car. So when I went on it, subhanallah, the more I appreciated the effort of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Whether you go walking or you go on a camel, how difficult that journey is. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went all the way to Taif for this da'wah. Even for those who go on Hajj and Umrah, when you think Mecca, Medina, you think it's a quick journey. is at least 4.5 hours by road. With drivers sometimes that drive a breakneck speed, suicidal speed, at least 4 hours between Mecca and Medina. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Taif. And he spent in Taif sallallahu alaihi wasallam 10 days, going from one leader to another leader, one noble aristocrat to another aristocrat. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in these 10 days met rejection and mockery. The best tribe was Banu Ali. And this tribe, they just kept quiet. They didn't reject what he came with, they didn't mock it, nor did they accept it. After 10 days, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam decided to leave Taif. And upon the departure of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the leaders of Taif, they decided to set upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the hooligans of the town, the ignorant, the foolish one, the slaves and the children. That this is such a lowly thing, this person is so insignificant to us, we send the children after him, the slaves, and also the hooligans of the time, upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to attack him. So as he was leaving Taif after 10 days, they stood in two rows. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed through the middle of them. And they started to attack the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with stones. Zayd ibn Haritha, it was like a bullet catcher for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did everything which he could do to protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and threw himself in the directions of the stones. But so severe was their attack that it could not protect the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam completely, that they stoned him sallallahu alaihi wasallam till he was drenched in his own blood. It was said that the shoe of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was filled with his blood. This is how severe this beating was and the stoning of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued to leave Taif in this situation, physically, mentally harmed, until he realized the extent of his injury. Because initially, when somebody hits you or stabs you or shoots you, you don't realize it initially. When he realized the extent of his injury sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he decided to rest by a wall, under a tree, in a wall. And this wall was a garden, and he rested under this tree, which in a garden that belonged to Utbah ibn Rabi'ah and Shayba ibn Rabi'ah, two people of Taif. And he rested under this tree, the shade of this tree, and it was a great tree. Utbah ibn Rabi'ah wa Shayba happened to be there when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was resting, and they saw him, and pity overtook them and sympathy overtook them for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they looked at him drenched and soaked in his own blood. So they sent their servant Adas, their slave, to serve the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam a bowl of grapes. So Adas, he went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he gave him the plate of grapes. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before putting the grape in his mouth, he said, "Bismillah." Adas was shocked. He said, "Ahlu hadhihi al-bilad la ya'rifu ma taquluhu." The people of these lands, they don't speak like this. They don't know what you're saying. At this point, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, "Min ayna anta wa ma dinuk?" Where are you from, if the people of the land don't say this? And what is your religion? Adas, he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ana min Naynawa wa ana Nasrani." He said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "I'm from Naynawa and I'm a Christian." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Min Naynawa balad, anta min balad, you are from the land Nabi as-Salih, the righteous prophet Yunus ibn Matta, the land of Yunus." He was shocked, because the Arabs are not people of the book. So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Wa ma a'lamuka bi Yunus?" How do you know about Yunus? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Dhaka nabi wa ana nabi." He was a prophet and I'm a prophet. And then he read some of the Qur'an to Adas. Now, since this lesson of Seerah is supposed to be about durus or ibar, lessons and things heeds we could take, I want us to pause here upon two great benefits from this just small incident with the Prophet ﷺ and Adas. The first benefit is that we mentioned earlier on, the importance of adab, etiquette and mannerism. Because it was this etiquette, this simple etiquette and mannerism of saying Bismillah, that drew the attention of who? Adas, to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. the importance of etiquette. If you want to quote Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your etiquette and your mannerism is very important. It draws people's attention. Look at Yusuf alayhi salam when he was in the prison. And the two prisoners were seeking interpretation of their dreams. They could have asked anybody in the prison. But they went to Yusuf alayhi salam. And this was an opportunity for him now to give da'wah, go to Tawheed. They went to him. And why did they go to him? They said, Inna naraka minal muhsinin. We see you as a doer of good because of his etiquette. And now you have many people that accept Islam in prison due to the etiquette of the Muslims in the prison. So this shows the importance of etiquette. And the etiquette which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he taught here was the etiquette of saying Bismillah before you eat. And this is especially important for our young children. Because the way this etiquette came about was a young person at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Amr ibn Salama, he came to the gathering of the Prophet and the Sahaba, as young children do, and he's putting his hand there everywhere. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Ya ghulam, O young boy, Sammillah. But the way he told him was with gentleness, love and compassion. So not only did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teach that young man or young boy the etiquettes of eating, he also taught those who do tarbiyah, education, cultivation, nurturing, the way to do tarbiyah, the way to cultivate and to educate. That he said to him gently and softly and nicely. Because you find many of us as fathers want to be on the sunnah. Our children come to a gathering, he does less than that. Breaks a plate, breaks a cup, which is less than not saying Bismillah. Or doesn't say Bismillah. You find we may rebuke him very harshly. Very harshly. But the Prophet didn't do this because he's a child. Because in terms of raising children, there's stages, three stages. The first stage before it reaches the age of childhood, as an infant, it's just pure love, playing. When he reaches childhood, children learn through playing. And all these things you find in the Sunnah that people have developed, Montessori learning system, that they learn through playing. You play with them, but at the same time, you start to inject some tarbiyah, correction in them. When they reach adulthood now, 16, 15, or 16, 17, you can't force them. You have to be like a friend to them. So at this stage, you find parents sometimes they're very harsh. He's a child. And they may go as far as hitting that child. They might go as far as that. In some cases, the parents may not go as far as that, and they may do their best to correct their child. But the problem sometimes is not the parents. The problem is the onlookers. Because the parent now, it feels very uncomfortable and shy and embarrassed because other people are looking at him like this. And he feels compelled, even though he's doing his best, that, look, son, please say Bismillah. People are just looking at him like this. So now he feels compelled to do something worse. So we as onlookers, when we see such things, it's either you look away, if you can't do anything, or you make the situation light by making it into a joke. Create a joke, but don't make it worse. Do not make it worse. Because if you love for your brother what you're for yourself, you want your brother to raise his child properly. Because our children, people that do this, is as though their children are infallible. They're angels, their children. And sometimes the children are not angels themselves. They look at the person like this. It reminds me of when we're younger as children in Nigeria, that your parents may be punishing you. And that punishment sometimes is a beating. And the doorbell rings, and he said, Alhamdulillah, Uncle such and such has come to your rescue. And he comes in. Not only does he come in and your mother's beating you and saying, you see what this boy, you'll be like, beat him more. You even encourage her to, even though now she's feeling, you know, like sometimes you want to fight, and you're like, hold me back, because you don't really want to fight. So she's complaining that, this, I'm going to do this, hoping he'll say, stop. He's like, do more. It's a serious issue. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught this young man the etiquette of Bismillah. He said to him, say Bismillah. Kul bi yameenik, eat with your right hand. We need to teach our children these etiquettes. Especially now that even amongst the Arabs in the Middle East, they have something called etiquette al-alami. Etiquette al-alami. Etiquette from the French word, etiquette. Universal etiquettes. That you find when you go to restaurants, they'll eat with a fork and knife, and there's nothing wrong with eating fork and knife. But the fork is in the left hand, the knife is in the right hand. And he said, no, brother, swap it around. They said, la ya akhi, hadha etiquette alami. This is international etiquette. This is how you're supposed to eat with fork or knife. Etiquette alami, that'll take you to Jahim and make you follow shaitan. No, teach them to eat with their right hand and never to be ashamed of this. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, kul mimma yaleek, eat from that which is near to you. that to teach them on the plate, on the bowl, because usually people eat from one plate. We should eat from one plate, because more barakah. But the reality of the time we're living in now, as families, people eat from different plates. In that case, if the plate is far from you, you could reach out and grab the plate to put something on his bowl. But if he's eating from one plate, if you want some meat over there, you could tell the person next to him, please pass this on. So the first lesson we get from this is the importance of adab in calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second fa'idah is the hirs. Before moving on to that, concern this etiquette. Some people might look at it as just something small, eat with your right hand. If a person rejects it out of mockery, like the one that said etiquette al-alami, as a man did in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "La astati'a, I can't eat with my right hand." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Wala astata'a, you'll never be able to do so." And this man, he became paralyzed in his hand. He could never raise his hands after that. And so many people that make mockery of the sunnah, you have to be very careful making mockery. Things have happened to them due to their mockery. Like the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if one of you wakes up from his sleep, he should wash his hand thalathan, before you touch anything, put your hand in a bowl of food. When you get up from your sleep at night, wash your hand three times. Because he doesn't know ayna bata yaduhu. He doesn't know where his hand rested. And this impurity is not necessarily a physical impurity, but a spiritual one, because the shaitan touches the hand of a person. So a person said, this is after Prophet sallam, in the time of the Salaf, a person said, "Ana a'rif ayna batat yadi." I know where my hand was. Ala sariri, on my bed. Out of mockery, and he became paralyzed in his hand after that. Some people make fun of the miswak. There's a man that made fun of the miswak, and he went to the extent of putting the miswak, not in his mouth, in an appropriate part of his body. And he bled from that part till he died because of mockery of the sunnah. See, these etiquettes are very important. So the second thing, fa'idah, we get from this is the hirs, the eagerness of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when it comes according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Muslim is a person that calls to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all times, in health, in sickness, in ease, in hardship. So here, you're bleeding, you've been stoned by these people, you may feel demotivated, but yet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he still used this opportunity of difficulty to call to Allah, and used the question of Abbas as an opportunity to call into Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And such were the Anbiya, even in times of difficulty. Yusuf alayhi salam, he was in prison and he was calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when they came to him to say to him, interpret the dream for us, it began with what? Interpretation of the dream? La, it began with Tawheed. He used the opportunity of interpreting a dream to begin with Tawheed. Then he interpreted the dream afterwards. So when they asked him to interpret the dream for them, what did Yusuf begin with? He said, "Ya sahibay as-sijin, my two companions in this prison. أَأَرْبَابُ مُتَفَرِّقُونَ خَيْرٌ. Is it better to have multiple laws? أَمِ اللَّهُ وَاحِدُ قَهَارٌ. Or Allah Ta'ala alone." So it began with Tawheed. So a Muslim is always beneficial, wherever he is. Use any opportunity, even if it's a bad one, or any situation, is opportunity to call to Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. After the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he took rest in this garden. And so magnificent was the issue of this adab and opportunity of da'wah that some of the ulama, they said, Adas, he accepted Islam, this Nasrani. He left and he continued. And before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew it, he had reached Wadi As-Sail. Wadi As-Sail is the point of miqat. If you're coming from Riyadh, for example, or what they call Najd, before you enter Makkah, this is your miqat, if you're going for Umrah. So you reach Wadi As-Sail. And upon reaching Wadi As-Sayyid, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw that appeared above him was a great cloud. Became cloudy and a great shadow above the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam looked up, this great shadow or this great cloud was Jibreel alayhi salam. And Jibreel came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ya Muhammad, O Muhammad, hadha malakul jibal. This is the angel of the mountain. Murhu bima shit. Order him with anything you want." If the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a person that called to himself at this moment, he will have said to the angels of the mountain, "Shake the earth from beneath their feet and turn them all upside down." But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not call to himself, and likewise the Sahaba who he cultivated did not call to themselves. So if you look at Ali radiallahu anhu, who was cultivated, educated by the Prophet ﷺ, in one of the battles, a person spat in his face. And Ali could have taken his head off. And he stopped and he paused. Why did he stop and he paused? Because he realized he's doing this for his what? His nafs, not for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kept quiet. Then the angel spoke, he said, إِنْشِتَ لَأُطَبِّقْ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَخْشَبَيْنِ. If you want, I could cause the Akhshabain, because Mecca has two famous mountains. He said, I could cause the two mountains, Abu Qubais is one of them, and the other one to come down upon them and crush them and grind them to completely. If you wish, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لَعَلَّ اللَّهِ maybe Allah, and it's a dua, يُخْرِجُ مِنْ أَصْلَابِهِمْ مَنْ يَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ وَلَا يُشْرِكُ بِهِ شَيْئًا. Those that worship Allah and don't associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look at this dua of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Indeed, Allah ta'ala took out from the offsprings of who? Ahlu Ta'if. Because when people mention this story, they think it's Ta'if. No, this was in Mecca. Because it was what it was saying. He said, maybe Allah would take from their offspring or bring from their offspring those who worship Allah, don't associate partners with Him. And from that came the reality that Allah Ta'ala took from their offsprings the worst of them, those who worship Allah, they associate partners with Him. And from amongst them came the greatest commanders that caused the greatest conquest and victories for Islam. So from the offsprings of the worst of them, and who's the worst of the mushrikeen? Who is Fir'aun in this ummah? Ya Luqman, ma li araka na'ima. Who's the Fir'aun of this ummah? I mentioned it many times, even last week. The Fir'aun, yes, of this ummah. In the Prophet's time, or this ummah. Abu Jahl, barakallahu fiqh, Abu Jahl. From the Fir'aun of this ummah came Ikrimah. Radiallahu an wa la'natullahi ala al-ab, Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl. Ikrimah was the son of Abu Jahl. And he brought for Muslims in Islam many conquests. And Ikrimah, he died shaheedan, he died as a martyr in the battle of Yarmouk. From the offspring of the mushrikeen was the son of As ibn Wa'il, was Amr ibn al-As. So the son of As ibn Wa'il, Amr ibn al-As. And from his offspring, his grandchildren came Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, one of the greatest scholars, and Ubad. From the worst of them, the richest of them, the one where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the ayah down for, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. Leave me alone with the one I created alone. Leave me with him, I'll deal with him. وَجَعَلْتُ لَهُ مَالًا مَمْدُودًا وَبَنِينَ شُهُودًا. I gave him much wealth and children. And who was this, ya akhi? Walid ibn Mughira. From the worst of the mushrikeen came Abu Sulaiman. Ya Sheikh Sulaiman, who's Abu Sulaiman? So far we've been dropping clues and clangers. There's a brother here actually, Akhul Amas. Yes, Aywa, Uthman. I owe him a present. But now we're going to do a double presentation of presents. Yes, Habib always asks me many questions. So I'm going to ask Habib a question today. Ya Habib, who's Abu Sulaiman? And we've been dropping clues everywhere. If you notice, there's a pattern that we've been dropping all the time. There's a pattern. A pattern. Pick up on the pattern. Ya Habib. Who is it? I just want to know the answer. Who is it? No, you don't have to know that. We've been dropping it all the time. No excuse. MashaAllah. You're good. You're good. If it wasn't to be a stereotypical or generic statement, or what sometimes people call a racist statement to make, I would have made the statement. That was a good one. I just came in. Because sometimes, subhanAllah, people make this generic sweeping statements, which sometimes is stereotyping a people and could be considered to be racist. Yes? But they said Nigerians are very good at getting out of questions. You know? The long pause, is thinking of what to say. I remember, subhanAllah, one time I was doing security, and you're not allowed to sleep on a security job at all. So they used to have mobile patrols that used to go around checking if you're sleeping. And there was two guards, a Muslim brother, Khan, And another Nigerian guy on guard that night. And Nigerian guy every night would sleep. Every night. So the security patrol, mobile patrol came around, but Khan was on patrol. So by the time he came back from patrol, the mobile patrol had entered the building. The guy was gone completely like this. And Khan was coming down the stairs. So he tried to warn him, but the guy said, shh, the supervisor, don't say anything. He opened the door, walked all the way to the guard that had been sleeping. And the guard was sleeping, and he sat in front of him. If it was me, I'd have woke up like this. Oh. Whoa, he didn't wake up like this. He was like this. I see you. You know I've been seeing you for a long time. I saw you. I saw you. So he didn't catch him in the act. Anyway, yes, Salman. Barakallahu fi. We said Abu Jahl was Ikrima ibn Abi Jahl. As ibn Wa'il, Amr ibn al-As, Walid ibn Mughira, Khalid ibn Walid was the son of who? Walid ibn Mughira. Barakallahu fi. Naam. This is the patterns we were dropping. Naam. Abu Sulaiman. The only one. Naam, Abu Sulaiman is the only Sahabi that's called Abu Sulaiman. Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu ta'ala anhu came from Walid ibn Mughira. After this, subhanAllah, to show indeed with after hardship comes ease. But another ease came after that. After Prophet left Wadi al-Say, he reached Wadi al-Nakhl. He reached Wadi al-Nakhl in Makkah. And the Prophet was praying Salah. And Salah in those days before Isra Mi'raj was two, before Fajr and before Maghrib. Fajr and Maghrib. And as he was praying, something magnificent happened. That you're going to call people in Taif to da'wah, and they didn't accept, but another set of, not people, another set of creation is going to accept Islam. Because before the advent of the Prophet ﷺ, the jinn, they used to go to the heavens to seek news from the heavens and to bring it to the Quran, the fortune tellers and the magicians. Because these magicians or people, these fortune tellers that claim to know the future, they're working with jinn. Even the ones that came to Muslim, Mushrikeen, Kuffar, that take news from these jinn. So the jinn, what they'll do, they'll climb one on top of the other in the same way the ants do, till they reach the heavens. And they'll steal news from the heavens and they'll pass it down to the one after them, to the one after them, till he reaches where? The dunya. Until he reaches the sahir or the kahin. But by that time, it's mixed with 100 lies. It's mixed with 100 lies. So they used to do this. But at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they themselves said, فَمَنْ يَسْتَعْمِ الْآنِ يَجِدْ لَهُ Shihaban Rasada. Allah used to send after them meteors and flying stars, shooting stars to destroy them. So they couldn't do it anymore. They used to try, فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعِ الْآنِ يَجِدْ لَهُ شِهَابًا. Hot flaming star chasing them and killing them. So they realized something had changed. So the jinn, they gathered and had a meeting that we could not do what we used to do before. Something must have changed. So the leaders of the jinn, he told the tribes of the jinn to go out on the earth to seek news of a change. What has happened? So whilst traveling the land, the jinn, they came across the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praying Fajr, and they heard the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this incident in the Quran, that وَإِذْ صَرَفْنَا إِلَيْكَ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْجِنِّ يَسْتَمِعُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. That when we directed a group of the jinn to you and they heard or listened to the Quran, فَلَمَّا حَضَرُوهُ قَالُوا أَنْصِتُوا. Subhanallah. When they heard the Quran, these are the jinn, at this time not Muslims, saying to one another, Ansitu, pay attention and listen attentively. And we, Subhana Malik al-Quddus, were reciting the Quran and people are raising their voice about the Quran. And these are jinn, they were not even Muslims. One of the first things in this gathering we used to have in Nigeria, they call it Asalatu. I didn't even know the meaning then of what this thing meant. They will say in the Nigerian accent, I'll see if you could guess it, Ansitu, Ansitu Lillah. I said, what is this ansitu lillah? But they take this from Quran. Ansitu, pay attention for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I know a brother, you know how congested the hajj is and the confusion and the chaos. He said one of the most difficult hujjah to control with the Nigerians. But he said, somebody taught him one thing to say. He said, as soon as ansitu lillah, all the Nigerians keep quiet. So he said, they said to each other, keep quiet, pay attention. فَلَمَّا قُضِيَ وَلَّوْا إِلَىٰ قَوْمِهِمْ مُنذِرِينَ. And when it was concluded, they went back as Muslims and warned us to their people and started to call the jinns to Islam. So in Wadi al-Nakhl, this is the first time that the jinn, they heard the Qur'an. So this is a victory that you're going to call a people, but Allah Ta'ala brought the jinn to al-Islam. Subhanallah. So the Prophet ﷺ stayed in Wadi al-Nakhl and he moved on from there to enter Mecca. But now you're going to Taif, if you come back, you're not going to enter Mecca so easily. So he sought al-Ijara, something we spoke about before. Protection from the different people in Mecca, the nobles of Mecca. Everybody rejected, except for Mut'im ibn Adi. And this time he wasn't a Muslim, he was a mushrik. He decided to give Ijara and he announced, Inni jarun li Muhammad. I'm a protector of Muhammad, he's under me. When he gave this protection to the Prophet ﷺ, he called all of his children, all of his cousins, to go and collect the Prophet ﷺ, musallahin, armed to the teeth. And he said, don't only be harmed to the teeth, put him in the middle of you. You surround him. And when the Prophet ﷺ entered Mecca, the first thing he did was tawaf. But in this tawaf, the whole of Bani Adi, the son of Mut'im, and his cousins, they surrounded the Prophet ﷺ and stood in guard. Subhanallah, that even this mushrik, they never brought the treaties. But another etiquette we learn from this is the sunnah of when you enter your hometown or your place of residence or after a journey. Many of us, we just go straight out of reach, alhamdulillah, I'm coming home, I should be home in 15 minutes. No, the first thing you're supposed to do, go to a masjid, pray two raka'ah. It's a sunnah mahjura, abandoned sunnah. Alhamdulillah, in Qatar, it's many masajid. Even if it's outside the masjid, they have a prayer mat outside there. You can just let yourself pray and go home. Always pray two raka'ah before you go home upon entering your place of residence. Now, after this, in the context of this surah, Al-Duha, it came down in this Am Al-Huzn, after these incidences. I'm going to go through Surah Al-Duha next week. There's some other incidents that happened, but it's been an extended dars today, you know. And I apologize to any of the sisters or the brothers with their wives up there that might knock me out afterwards, that what you might interpret to be harsh, but it's, wallahi, it's very unbecoming, this situation in the masjid. Very, very unbecoming. And if it's from children, it may be acceptable, so long as the parents are doing their best to control that child. So long as they're doing their best, do not be harsh on parents. Because some sisters, especially those from non-Muslim family, the only time they get to socially interact with anybody is on this day, on Friday. And they don't have Muslim families. And some people have situation with their children. If you see a mother is trying her best with a child, you leave the child. The child could have issues, ADHD, you know, attention deficiency, hyperactive disorder, mental issues that you are not aware of. So it's better to make excuses. The child could be autistic, for example. Just make excuses and leave them. But adults, they shouldn't have such behaviors. SubhanAllah, bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Any questions, inshallah?